Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We are pleased to have you with us this afternoon as we remember and give thanks for a very special and unique ministry in our midst. Some of you may have heard that there was today a very serious accident on Interstate 79 down near the Zelianople exit, and the traffic, we understand, is very badly tied up. We do understand there are some people still making their way here because of that traffic problem, including one of our scripture readers, that being Susan Bailey. We hope that she will be able to make it in time. If anybody sees her come in, would you please give her some assistance in finding us and shooing her up to the front of the church where we will put her to work in due order. Also, it would be appropriate, of course, to be remembering whoever it is involved in that accident and be thinking of them and their safety during the prayer time as well. Together we are the body of Christ and individually members of him. It is in that spirit of community that we invite all of us to join in worship and worship together. Let us do so. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death. For as we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Let us pray. Father, we give thanks for that life that has been so remarkably lived and whose memory brings us together this afternoon. Even more, we think of your work on our behalf and the promise of resurrection, which gives us hope even in the midst of tears and sadness and loss. Grant us now the conviction of promised scriptures, knowing that those promises are for us and for all of those who have loved the Lord and been loved by him in turn. In his name we ask it. Amen. Our first hymn of the day is number 468. If able, please stand and join in the singing.
Thank you.
If we should say that we have no need, then we do not know ourselves. If we should say we have no hope, then we do not know God. Let us, in the balance of these twin truths, approach God in prayer. Holy God, you see us as we are and know our inmost thoughts. We confess that we are unworthy of your gracious care. We forget that all life comes from you and that to you all life returns. We have not always sought or done your will. We have not lived as your grateful children, nor loved as Christ loved us. Apart from you, we are nothing. Only grace can sustain us. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us, heal us, and make us whole. Set us free from our sin and restore to us the joy of your salvation, now and forever. Amen. This is the good news, that we have not been abandoned in our sin, but that the Lord came to us, was born and raised, lived, suffered, died, and rose again, that by such actions we might see and receive the forgiveness of God himself. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever. You may be seated.
The 23rd Psalm was a compass and a creed for Kenneth Bailey. On a papyrus, he had it written and framed, and he looked at it every day in Arabic. It is likely the psalm that he first memorized as he was learning the Arabic language. I will read it in Arabic. الرب راعي فلا يعوزني شيء في مراع خضر يربضني إلى مياه الراحة يوردني يرد نفسي يهديني إلى سبل البر من أجل اسمه أيضا إذا سرت في وادي ظل الموت لا أخاف شرا لأنك أنت معي عصاك وعكازك هما يعزيانني ترتب قدامي مائدة تجاه مضايقية مسحت بالدهن رأسي كأسي ريا إنما خير ورحمة يتبعانني كل أيام حياتي وأسكن في بيت الرب إلى مدى الأيام.
John chapter 10, beginning with the verse numbered 1 and concluding with the 18th. Jesus, the Good Shepherd. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father." This is the word of the Lord.
A reading from the first epistle of Peter, chapter 5, beginning with the first verse. "Now as an elder myself and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as one who shares in the glory to be revealed, I exhort the elders among you to tend the flock of God that is in your charge, exercising the oversight not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you do it, not for sordid gain, but eagerly. Do not lord it over those in your charge, but be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will win the crown of glory that never fades away. In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders, and all of you must clothe yourselves with humility in your dealings with one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves, keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen."
Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory
forever. I came from Egypt as much as to express my condolences to the dear family and friends of Ken Bailey, to comfort myself by being among you. I needed this for a man who had such a wonderful, amazing impact on my life, my career, my vision, and my leadership. I stand before you with mixed feelings of the sadness of the great loss of this giant on the one hand, and the sense of celebration of gratitude to God for a life that couldn't have been lived better. I try to express these feelings in a short period of time, and I couldn't find a better way than to speak about this storyteller, the story of the storyteller, and the parable of the parable's interpreter. The life of Ken Bailey, the student and the scholar of the parables of Jesus, became in itself as a parable and example that needs to be remembered, told and retold for generations to come. And here are some examples of what I mean. Ken Bailey made himself a parable of the good soil towards God's call. While many missionaries' kids of his generation were surely frustrated to live in primitive and undeveloped mission fields of their parents, Ken made his heart a good soil towards the seed of the kingdom scattered in the Middle East field, which led him to give his whole life to this part of the world. Ken Bailey made himself a parable of Jesus' incarnation. as his Lord, he echoed the incarnation of his Lord in his life. And as a missionary, Ken Bailey didn't act as someone who was struggling to humble himself to serve illiterate villagers, nor as someone who was suffering to bear such an undeveloped culture. He rather acted with joy and pride, one who belonged to this culture. Thus, the people of the Middle East treated him as one of them, as an Egyptian, as Lebanese, as Palestinian. We used to call him sometimes Amme Bailey, or Sheikh Bailey, Uncle Bailey, or Elder Bailey. Ken made himself a parable of carrying the cross. During his years of service, Ken carried the cross like his Lord, whom he loved and served. In Egypt, he was forced to leave the country he loved and served. What broke his heart then, that some of the people he served with contributed with the security intelligence at that time to kick him out of the country. In Lebanon, he faced some tough intimidations from people who were supposed to support and protect him. Later on, he suffered the loss of his dear son David, a matter that was quite difficult for him. In all these incidents and many others, he accepted what happened. He carried the cross as a gift from the Lord. Ken Bailey made himself a parable of a lucky farmer and smart merchant. He explained many times how illiterate Middle Easterners comprehended easily many accounts of the Bible, which were difficult to Western biblical scholars. When he discovered this fact, he acted as a lucky farmer who discovered a treasure. He hid this treasure until he equipped himself scholarly with Semitic languages and literature. Then, as a smart merchant, he happily dispensed with many things to establish his own distinctive scholarship in New Testament. Ken made himself a parable of a well-instructed scholar. He was like a scribe, instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven, and like a householder who brings out of his treasure always things new and old. Finally, Ken ended his earthly race as a parable of a good and faithful servant in God's kingdom. I can hear the Lord saying to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. To conclude, my friends, dear family and friends of Ken Bailey, as we recall such great memories of this giant, we either would increase our sense of loss or increase the sense of gratitude to God for giving us the privilege to know Ken Bailey, to be close to him, to learn from him, to serve with him, and be served with him. I would rather that we choose the second approach. May the Lord comfort your hearts and our hearts. I carry lots of words of condolences from friends of Egypt, and I couldn't take more time. So what I did is just I put some of them here in this booklet. So please allow me to produce or present one to the family and one to the foundation.
Many responses have come from around the world since Ken's passing. I'm impressed by how often the messages speak of Ken as a humble, gracious, and kind gentleman, and he was all of that and more. And he was also a proud man, but it was a holy pride. He took his vocation in the church, his calling to serve the church and to serve his Lord, very seriously. But Ken would not agree to a eulogy if he were here today. He would say that this service should be about the grace of God as demonstrated in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what he would say. So instead of a eulogy, I will simply reflect on the significance of Ken Bailey's life as a gift from God to the world Christian community. There are many things that could be said, and I hope that you will use this occasion to say them to each other. But I will mention only three. Number one, at a General Assembly luncheon about 10 years ago, I was asked to introduce Ken. It seemed rather exaggerated, but I said, "Ken Bailey is the most important New Testament scholar in our generation." And I believe it even more so today. Maybe not the best known, maybe not the most decorated, maybe not the occupant of the most prestigious chair in the most prominent seminary or university, but he was the most important New Testament scholar for the world Christian community today. 15 years ago, Jim Walther, himself an excellent New Testament scholar at Pittsburgh Seminary, said, "Ken's work will be discovered and become widely influential 50 years from now."
That's true.
All of us have seen his study sheets in lectures that we have attended. Ken's formatting of the texts in chiastic form introduced us to understandings of Jesus' parables that we had never seen before. He once presented a lecture in Australia on why Jesus never wrote a book. His point was to affirm Jesus' confidence in the accuracy of oral transmission of his teaching. In a Middle Eastern context, he did not need to write a book for his teaching to be remembered. 15 years ago, N.T. Wright and James Dunn, both well-recognized world-class New Testament scholars, acknowledged that they used Ken's understanding of oral tradition as the foundation of their work. Another New Testament scholar, well-known to everyone here today, has said it was beyond his ability to evaluate Ken's work because, like virtually every other scholar in the Western Church, he was not fluent in Arabic and he could not read the ancient Aramaic and Syriac as Ken could. We can all remember that it was from Ken that we learned that there was no mean innkeeper in Bethlehem. That it was actually an insult to the culture of the community, as Victor and Sarah can tell you, who live there, to suggest so. That small example from the Christmas story is hardly the tip of the iceberg of what we have begun to understand from Ken's vast contextual knowledge. That's why he was, first of all, the Bible teacher of the church, not the academy. Yet, he was no amateur simpleton, but a scholar of the highest academic standard. That is why he was so much in demand by pastors and why so many of them are seated here today. He answered as many as 200 letters a year about New Testament questions, and he didn't even use email until the last several years of his life, and then only with a few people. One of the pastors in this room admitted that he would call him on Saturday night and ask him a question. It's no wonder that his books and articles were translated into more than 20 languages, some of which we have never heard. More than 10 years ago, Ken received a letter from a pastor in Nepal. A missionary had given the pastor a couple of Ken's videos. He and his wife were working among a tribal group, and he wrote to Ken, "We have gone through intense persecution, to the point even of death. God has protected us and given us his strength. We have several churches and pastors." The pastor was writing because he wanted Ken to send him more of his material so he could train his pastors. Number two, when Ken and Mickey retired to New Wilmington 20 years ago, his advisory committee became more active and eventually developed into the Foundation for Middle Eastern New Testament Studies, what we call FOMENS. The board only met once or twice a year at the Bailey's home, but it was a feast, not just Arabic coffee and sweets, because Ken would prepare a 5 to 10 page report on what he had been writing, where he had been lecturing, and his emerging vision for the cultural contribution of the ancient churches and that it be made available to the world Christian community. Ken was actually better known around the world among Catholic, Anglicans, and others than he was among Presbyterians. Averaging 150 lectures a year in his retirement, his ecumenical heart embraced the emerging church of the global South. He delighted in telling us how the philosopher Descartes famously said, "I think, therefore I am." But a pastor leading worship in the Middle East would say, "I am because we are," to which the liturgical response of the people was, "We are because he is." A very different way to read the scriptures. Ken was among the earliest to see the decline of the church in Europe and North America in juxtaposition to the ascendancy of the church in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. He told the story of lecturing on preaching to a class in Beirut, encouraging them to avoid too many personal illustrations in their sermons. Ezekiel, a Dinka student from the South Sudan, wanted to make sure that he understood, and so he asked the professor if referring to his personal story was an example of what he meant, and Ken asked him to tell his story. The government lit a fire in the high grass around the village, and everyone panicked and ran. One terrified woman was so desperate that she threw her child into the grass and ran. "I grabbed the child, and it took me 3 days to find her." The hush in the room was like this. And Ken declared, "The professor is not qualified to teach this class." Ken Bailey wrote and spoke for people like that. He embraced a deep ecumenicity that goes beyond anything we know by the name ecumenical. He knew better than most how desperately the church in the West needed partners like Ezekiel, the Dinka from South Sudan. Number three, in the last conversation which Joan and I had with Ken, he said, "It's important to support women leaders." He spoke of Ann Zaki, an outstanding Egyptian woman teaching at Cairo Seminary. He had seen her video about ISIS murders of the poor Coptic workers in Libya. He was encouraging me to find a way to involve her in the Foundation for Middle Eastern New Testament Studies. Ken says we must work to encourage women leaders in the Middle East. He had been doing that all his life. Time and again, he returned in his writing and in his speaking to what the New Testament said about women. His insights into scripture on gender issues were far more compelling than any other that we've ever heard. of any of this or any extra biblical rationale. These are simply three examples of the significance of Ken Bailey's life as a gift from God to the world Christian community. I'm sure that you're here because of Ken's significance in your life. But it's also important to acknowledge what Ken made very clear many times. The most important woman, Mickey, his wife of 64 years, was the light in his darkness. She had a major part in God's gift to all of us. I want to conclude with the last paragraph of Ken's lecture at Trinity School of Ministry in Ambridge on January 12th. It was on the authority and purpose of Scripture. His final paragraph. The church, living under the authority of Scripture, is not a snowman in grave danger of melting because of the burning rays of a hot secular sun that is beating down upon it. Rather, it is the flock of God, saved by the divine shepherd, who safely leads his sheep through angry waters to quiet inlets, where the sheep can drink and be renewed, to go in and out as they live their lives and fulfill their ministries. Having received amazing grace sufficient to overcome many dangers, toils, and snares, may it be so with us today. This is just a beginning reflection on the significance of Ken Bailey's life as a gift from God to the world Christian community.
And remembering that we are community and that we do not stand alone, but that we are part of a great cloud of witnesses, let us stand together again and say what the church believes. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and of earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Would you be seated?
Sisters and brothers, let us pray. All thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, lover, beloved, and love itself. All our best praise and thanks to you this day for every good gift you have given us in this life, some of the more precious of which we have just professed: your Holy Spirit, your Holy Catholic Church, the communion of your saints, the forgiveness of our sins. And Lord, those most mysterious and marvelous gifts to which we cling this day, the resurrection of the body and life with you everlasting. All thanks and praise to you for these. like a father who risks reputation to welcome home a wayward son, like a mother who unwearingly listens to the supplications, the requests of her ancient, anxious child. You, O Lord, are more generous, more forbearing, more faithful than we have dared to pray or proclaim or practice. And so, O Lord, on this day, in this hour, in this good space long dedicated to the proclamation of Jesus as shepherd and savior and your very self in our midst, oh, how we bless you, O Lord, for sending us a son, but also for sending us so many others in his wake who have helped us hear his word and notice his way. For preachers and prophets, for the tutelage of good teachers, for the long hours of labor when faith seeks understanding, for those who see and hear your living word and then, with the fire of the good news burning in their bones, patiently and persistently help the rest of us to know and be known. For those who before us peer into the vacated Friday tomb and behold your stunning promises, and who then come running back to the rest of us with that life-rearranging news of the Lord of life and the death of death. O Lord, for servants of your gospel and stewards of your living word, hear us say, thank you. Thank you, O Lord, for your child and our brother, Kenneth Bailey. We will resist our temptation to revere him for his work, for that would be to miss his point and surely to invoke his holy ire and yours. For he steadfastly pointed always and only to you. We will, however, Holy Spirit, bless you, and we will give you our reverence for the son, husband, father, grandfather, preacher, teacher, scholar, servant, and friend in ministry he was to so many around your world. We bless you for well more than half a century of wedded life and love and mutual ministry between Ken and Mickey, who together bore witness to your covenant faithfulness by the steadfastness of their own vows. We bless you, O Lord, for the good hope of the resurrection to come, for that sturdy promise that holds son David and his many gifts in your good care, and likewise bolsters today daughter Sarah and husband Victor with peace and promise and ministry yet to do. We bless you for the ministry of good grandfathers who teach us about matters not found in books or manuscripts, who bequeath to grandchildren good jokes, goofy moments, and the memories of split wood fires and story upon story upon story. And so we pray for Kelsey and Cameron and Mother Leslie and indeed the whole Bailey clan. Confirm in them all that peace which surpasses even the best of our understanding. And we pray, O Lord, that you would draw them together in the coming days in that sort of love which, like a strap of strong leather fashioned by a craftsman, binds them together. in harmony and in shalom. We are your prodigal people, O Lord. When at last we come to our shallow senses, when finally we curse the far country of our wandering ways, when the piggish pods of sentiment and platitude no longer preach, you always welcome us home. And so thank you for lighting the lamp we call Jesus and searching your house for the likes of us. Thank you for risking even the safety of the saved, the 99 already in church, to go looking, like any good shepherd would, for those of us who have been that one lost sheep. Holy Spirit, you have met us here in this communion this afternoon and will still in the preached word. Likewise, we pray for communions of your saints everywhere your gospel abides, in villages in rural Egypt, in classrooms in Lebanon, among students in Palestine and Israel, in fellowships of believers from Cyprus to Shenango, among Anglicans and Orthodox and Presbyterians and prodigals of every stripe and tribe. We pray your blessings upon every communion far and wide, where the name of Jesus is now better known. And in his name, we together pray his prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke, beginning in chapter 15, verse 11. Then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me.' So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens in that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough to spare? But here I am, dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off, and he went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. and get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard the music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, "Your brother has come back, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has got him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, "Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours comes back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him." Then the father said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." The word of the Lord.
I grew up on the original Star Wars trilogy. And so if you'll forgive the metaphor, I feel like we have lost our Yoda. He was the greatest among us, and yet the most humble. He was the only one of his kind, and there will never be another Ken Bailey. It was Ken who first instilled in me a fascination for and a deep love of Scripture when I was just a little boy. And so it is a deep honor for me today to bring the word of the Lord to you in this his service, and I am deeply grateful to the Bailey family. Hear now the word of the Lord through his servant Paul to his beloved church in Philippi. And perhaps today we ought to hear these words as the word of the Lord through his servant Ken to his beloved church in Western Pennsylvania, across the Middle East, and indeed around the world. "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. And the God of peace will be with you." The word of the Lord.
And John's account of the resurrection as it is found in the 20th chapter of his gospel. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. And so she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." And then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. And he saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. And then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. And then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." And when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" And supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." And Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. You've been seated quite a while. May I invite you to stretch and stand and sing praise to God with our next hymn, "Of the Father's Love Begotten."
Hello.
My hunch this afternoon is that all of us can well appreciate the words and the feelings of Mary of Magdala on that first Easter morning, perhaps the greatest day in human history. She had gone to the tomb that day simply to do her due diligence, to prepare the body for the final stage of burial. That's all she hoped, all she expected, all she anticipated. And of course, you know how the story goes, how in the first signs of coming dawn, she spots a figure that she assumes is the gardener. And of course, it turns out he is anyone but the gardener. And when he speaks her name and recognition is made, John's gospel then goes on to say that Jesus spoke to her and said, "Do not hold on to me." Now, if we had before us, and maybe some of you do, the old King James Version, 1611, version of John's gospel, you will discover it doesn't say that at all. As a matter of fact, the old King James translation of those words of Jesus are these: "Do not touch me." Now, that's not a difference without a distinction, it seems to me, because what happened over the centuries is that a whole Gnostic — Ken didn't think much of the Gnostics, you may know — gave rise to a whole Gnostic interpretation about the separation of the spiritual and the physical, about how the very touch of human being upon the resurrected Jesus was contaminating. "Don't touch me. Stand back. Keep your distance. Don't touch." But it was later generations who have discovered what virtually all the modern translations of Scripture indicate: that the Greek verb is continual action, that it's not touch, it's hold. It's cling, it's grasp. It is Mary, in my imagination, and perhaps in yours as well, on her knees, and she is holding on for dear life, because it is dear life that she is so terrified of losing again and losing forever. My hunch is a little of that is in all of us today. If you didn't feel that way, you wouldn't be here. We would have very much liked to have held on a lot longer. A few days after Ken's death, I received an email message. I've had it for a longer period than Ken has, but I received an email message from a dear friend, and it was a great message. But it began with the words, "I'm so sad at the untimely death of Dr. Bailey." And I was struck by that because I found myself feeling the same way. The untimely death. It took me a moment to remember. Ken was 85 years old. See? According to Psalm 90, that's a good bit more than we have any right to expect. 70 years, the psalmist says, maybe 80 by reason of strength. Ken got 85. He got the full meal deal. See? 85 on his way to 86. What I think happened is that Ken was so vibrant, so alive, so alert, so thoughtful right up to the end that we continually thought of him as a much younger man. Someone said, visiting with him in the hospital just a few weeks ago, that he seemed somewhat distracted, somewhat lost in thought. And the visitor — I can't remember who it was, if it was one of you, I apologize — but someone then said to him, "Well, Ken, what's the matter? You seem a bit distant today." And his response was, I've decided to write another book. It's time for my memoirs, and I'm outlining the chapters in my mind. Yes, we would have liked to have held on a bit longer. You know, sometimes I am asked what it was like to preach with Ken in the congregation. And it's often asked with a kind of awe, the way very few people speak to me. A kind of, wow, what was that like? How incredible that must have been to have had Ken in your congregation. What was that like? And my kind of standard teasing response was to say, well, I don't preach much on the parables anymore. And then you know what he did. He wrote a book on Paul. Then one on Jesus. My corpus of possibility was shrinking rapidly. We've just finished a year-long study on Obadiah. We would have liked to have held on a lot longer. But that's not the way of life. It's not the way of this world. There comes a time, as Mary had to learn in the garden, when we just have to let go. And part of that is what we're doing today. We're steeling ourselves against the task of letting go, of going on without him. It's not easy. We're feeling it. The loss is palpable. And it is real, of course. When I went to the Shenango home, the Shenango on the Green, the night that Ken passed away, as I was going in the doors, dear friend of the family, Mary Louise Ireland, who I think I saw somewhere. Are you here, Mary Louise? Where are you at? There we are. Mary Louise was coming out, and she was the first to speak. She said, you know, I know it's all right. I think I'm paraphrasing, but I'm pretty close. I know it's all right. It's not as if we don't know where he is. And yet it hurts. She nailed it. We do feel some loss, but it's ours, isn't it? For Ken, the pain of death has ended. And he has entered into the glorious beyond. It's easy to let my imagination just go a little bit and wonder what it must be like in those beyond those pearly gates right now. I'm sure the first act was to meet up with his dear friends and family who have preceded him, with David, of course, with his parents, Harold Kurtz, Jack Lorimer, a whole host of others. Spend a whole day just catching up. But I'm betting that tomorrow he has breakfast planned with Luther. There's brunch with Bart. Lunch, I think, will be Calvin. There's a few things he wants to straighten that brother out about. And the rest of the day with St. Paul. Wouldn't you like to be a fly on the wall of heaven tomorrow? We must let go. But Jesus goes on to say to Mary, not that we let our loved ones go to fall into the nihilistic abyss, but to fall into the arms of the one who has loved him and whom he has served for so long and so well. Mary Louise is absolutely right. It hurts, and we feel it. Paul, writing to the Thessalonians, said, "We grieve, but not as those who have no hope." It seems to me, dear friends, that that's the difference that sets us apart. That's the difference. But may I suggest to you today that it's the difference that makes all the difference. Through Christ our Lord, even the risen one. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will see.
On behalf of the Bailey and McCary families, I would like to express our thanks to each of you, our dear friends and extended family, who have come from near and far, and to all who have sent us messages of support. Thank you for the love, concern, and comfort you have shown us by your presence in this church and in spirit with your thoughts and prayers during the weeks of my father's illness. We are grateful to you for sharing these moments of worship of Almighty God and for the remembrance of my beloved father, who so deeply cherished, loved, and cared for his family and friends. How he would have enjoyed and delighted in seeing and visiting with all of you today. I would like to extend special thanks to the pastor of Trinity Presbyterian Church, Dr. William Crooks, and to the congregations of Trinity and the New Wilmington Presbyterian Churches, as well as to the Presbytery of Shenango, and to all who participated in leading our service of worship today. We are also grateful to those who took part in arranging the many details pertaining to the service and to the rest of the day, to those who hosted guests in their homes, and those who provided transportation from Pittsburgh Airport. Too many to enumerate or name. First and foremost, we thank you for standing with us in witness to the grace of God that called Ken Bailey to the ministry he has now fulfilled. My father lived his life and raised my brother David and me according to the words that Reverend Long read earlier from Philippians 4. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. It is these verses particularly which I want to leave you with this afternoon, as we thank you for joining us in witness to Christ's resurrection, wherein we are assured of Ken Bailey's resurrection with the saints, and upon which our own faith is firmly anchored.
Let us stand for the benediction. Դեր օրտնեցես եւ բահեցես Դեր իր թեմքը բայձարացնեց ձեր վրա եւ ողորմեցեսի Դեր իր երեսը վերցնեց ձեր վրա եւ խաղաղություն դացեսի եւ հիմա մեր Դեր Հիսուս Քրիստոսի շնորհքը Հոր Աստուծո Սերը եւ Սուրբ Հոգին հաղորդությունը ձեր բոլորին հետ լան հիմա եւ միշտ հավիտյանս հավիտենից Amen.
أفكاركم في المسيح يسوع ربنا ونعمة ربنا ومخلصنا يسوع المسيح تكون معكم وتدوم فيكم من الآن وإلى الأبد آمين
Now may the love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship and communion of his Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, now and forever, world without end. Amen. Amen. Again, thanks for coming. We are going to have, as the bulletin indicates, a reception downstairs provided by some folks in both the New Wilmington Church and the Trinity Church. The easiest way to make access to the fellowship hall is through the back doors and just straight down the steps, and I think you'll find that some good folks are awaiting you. God bless.